This is Face to Face with the co-founders of the National Association of Expert Advisors, Jay Kinder and Michael Reese.
We believe that we can change the real estate industry. There is a better way to sell real estate.
Your success is ultimately a sum of the decisions that you make.
And they're really developing a process, a set of guidelines, a set of procedures.
They're also best-selling authors.
Here today to discuss the issue is Jay Kinder and Michael Reese.
You know, right now, our efficiency in the ISA department has increased significantly. We're running two different ISA models, but what we're seeing is more than half of our appointments are coming from nurtures, and one-third of all of our closings came from the expert data last month.
Right. So those are two differentiators. Now, so tell me, let me ask this. So I know that some of the efficiencies from the home value side and some of the marketing and even just calling expert data.
Yeah.
Those nurtures and whatnot, you've identified, you've applied some optimization to those funnels to try to convert faster through some of that.
Yep.
What's been the initial result of that in terms of generating more sellers?
I would say that
I'm actually genuinely interested in your answer.
Yeah. I would say that right now where we're seeing, From the actual marketing side of things, we're seeing about a 6% appointment set rate on one lead source that we're attempting to scale out.
Right.
So we're looking for additional traffic sources to continue to build that predictability in that funnel. I would say, man, dude, there's been so many updates. Now that we're even talking about this,
right,
it's like going to be really exciting.
Right.
I'm excited to do this podcast.
All right. Hey, we are here face to face, Jay Kinder and
Michael Reese.
And I'm getting my updates. So we run around like a cat with our tails on fire. So I don't get updates for Michael on partner as often as I would like. It's good to know. I know that you guys are rocking and rolling. I hear bits and pieces here and there, but I'm excited to see scaling the seller side of the business. I mean, that's the thing that we know is that you can continue to optimize and improve. And it's exciting.
Yeah.
So I want to know, I want to talk about specifically a couple things. Number one, I want to really identify that biggest problem in recruiting agents.
Okay.
And I just want to talk about the difference between the buyer's agents and the approach that we used to take with hiring buyer agents and what a conversation with a partner looks like, what's different about that, who it's right for, who it's not right for.
Yep.
And maybe just some nuances that you've picked up on, as you've been doing that and going through that process. And I'd also like to talk to you on this episode. We've been getting a ton of responses. First of all, thanks for tuning in. Thanks for listening. Thanks for your feedback. A lot of people we respect in the industry that are running big businesses are echoing the pain that they felt in their business and the misalignment of their vision for their company to what what they're trying to accomplish and we appreciate that. We genuinely love talking to you about this all day every day, but there's no way for us to have the number. I get texts every single day.
People that I have tons of respect for that are listening to the podcast, and I had no clue.
Right.
I mean, it makes sense, obviously, understanding their challenges and being in the community, but amazing.
Right, we appreciate you. So if you're slinging 400, 500, 600 homes and you're tuned into us, that we consider that an honor. So thank you for that, and thank you for your feedback. And we love the powwow, you know what I'm saying? So like, we're trying to solve these problems. The opportunity for us to do that and get back to everyone is just not realistic, right? So the best way for that to happen is through like the Exponential Growth Summit, which is coming up, is a good way for us to spend some time together and for us to expand on some of these topics and go deeper with you on that in a much more specific way that will give you a lot more information than we're able to do phone calls. I know, Mike, you were on the phone last night. After we left here at 9:30 p.m., you were on the phone at 10:30 and then another call at 11:30. And I don't know what happened after that, but I know you read the article on Spotify after that probably.
Yeah.
So like, we're burning the candle at both ends. I mean, we're up at 4-something in the morning and, up till 11 to 12 o'clock, sleeping 4 hours a day. So don't think that if we're not getting back to you that we don't love you and don't respect you and don't want to have the conversation. It's just difficult to do that at the scale and the magnitude of which we're growing. So, but let's dig into some of those that the heart of, you know, that the difference and why the impact is what it is and why people are responding so well to it, specifically the mega agents that have, you know, those large teams like we've always had, why it's resonating maybe.
Yeah, I think so. The I think I might have said this in the past and it might be redundant, but if people are listening for the first time, when we started Partner, one of the things that happened was there was this question that we would ask people and that would come onto the team, because at the beginning, as we're NAEA is providing support to a distribution network of real estate services across the country, and we're opening these hubs. We opened one in Atlanta, one in Houston. We go through these different phases in the process. The fundamental thing that I think was interesting, and you kind of, you know, you buy into a concept, but I just remember, like, even reading marketing books, man, like growing through our process of becoming marketers over time,
right,
that you would read something and you were doing something, but you thought you knew why, and then you were like, oh, I'm skipping that step, and that was so important.
Right.
I can't believe I didn't see that,
right,
that like step in psychology in that funnel and why it needed to be that way.
Or, oh, yeah.
You know, just learning.
You miss a little step and you don't get the result. A lot of people stop doing it and
right.
say it didn't work. That
exactly.
doesn't work. That can't work.
Yeah.
I already did it. I already tried it. But
and they missed the little thing.
Right. The people that are on this podcast, that ain't them. They, you know, they continue to try to make it work. But yeah, I get what you're saying. I've done that so many times. I thought I was a good copycatter and I wasn't.
Right. Exactly.
Right.
And so what I learned, and this is just part of the process, is that people, when they're introduced to this model, they want to still, you can, calling somebody's a partner when they're a buyer agent does not make them a partner. And that's
right.
what I'm. That's
a
probably
great
the thing
point.
That I've learned is, internally, you know, I've had actual partners. These are very sophisticated people that aren't looking to be buyer agents. And so in this process that we call our, and I'm going to give them a little bit of glimpse into the process.
Right.
When we meet with a top producing team, we have a team that was, they go through this process, and part of this process is the flip, and the flip is where we take their current model and we flip it over to the partner model. And that process has a process, everything from documenting all their internal systems and tools that they're using to align with the systems and tools that we use and find out what things we're not going to stop doing, because we're not going to stop doing things that are working and have positive ROIs. A lot of times when we peel back the curtain, we need to go in and really do a deep dive on all the financial modeling and make sure that we're
not everything to the dashboards.
Yeah. And stop doing things that we were just doing because
looked at it in a while.
Exactly.
Right.
So there's a lot of cleaning up that happens, you know, to get that operational efficiency that you need in order to run the partner. But what happens is that psychology piece is we flip these agents over, and some of them are partner material, and then unfortunately some of them are just really great buyer's agents. And there is a difference.
In context, can I just to make sure that they're clear on what were the two differences there? One, the first scenario, not the buyer agent
yeah.
process, but the process you're talking about where we do the flip and look at someone's business, go in and plug in all their dashboards. That's a producing 200, 300, 400, 500 deals area partner type potential, where we come in and flip their business from a bunch of buyer agents to partners, and we layer all the distribution services from NAEA and layer that into their business model, and we flip and show them what it looks like, and we move forward together into that area. So there's a process for how you're doing that at the high level with territories that are open in terms of area territories. And then there's the conversation that we all are having every day about our buyer agents that are in our business that are not making their calls, or they're not producing, or they didn't show up today, or
right.
you're trying to manage them with a stick.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And you wonder why you're so frustrated and there's so much turnover.
Right.
And you're meeting, you know, and when you meet with a partner, what's different about, and that's where you're at. That process is different, and what is it like is where you're at, right?
Yes, absolutely.
I just want to make sure everybody could cover the gap between the two.
Yeah, so there is two flips. We flip an area partner, and then and the one thing I wanted to say, because I was actually about to do what I say you shouldn't do, I don't, a partner is a partner, and that partner owns their business. And the reason I say that is because a partner might not have buyer agents. A partner might have a listing agent. We do not dictate to these people.
To our partners,
how to run their business.
Right.
What I always say is, when you're sitting down with a partner, talk to them like you would talk to me or Jay.
Right.
Because if me and Jay came to work with you, that's the level of caliber of person you're building into your business. And what I mean by that is sometimes what I see, and I've seen, it's not by default, but like we want to say, if you don't do this, like you were saying with the stick, then right. You're not going to get that.
Right.
If you're having to have that conversation, they're not a partner.
Right.
That's the bottom line. And that's okay.
Right.
But this isn't to create a layer of management for you, at the hub level. That's left up to the partner to decide if they want to be in the management business. We've removed ourselves.
Right.
The partner is now working through the distribution network. And there is a function that we're providing a certain level of, because remember this, for example, this distribution network, this team, they went from 30 transactions, they're probably doing just under 4 million in commission, 100 million, a year in sales. They've learned a lot.
Right.
They're more than capable of helping somebody in their community go from 3 to 5 million and build their business in a very specific area, and that's the relationship. And so what I think people have to understand is that the reason why this is important is because this impacts recruiting. See, I talk to people that are looking to recruit, and if you read the nature of their ads, they're recruiting buyer agents.
Right.
We're not doing that.
Right.
We're not recruiting buyer agents. We're a conversation that you would have with the buyer agent. We talked about this last time where someone came on the team last week, and in the last episode, episode 7, where
right.
the girl that I knew was becoming, like that actual interview process that you have with the partner is an opportunity meeting. You know what they want to see? They want to see the math.
Right.
They want us to understand the opportunity.
Right.
They want to know the numbers.
Yeah. When was the last time you had a buyer agent that you interviewed want to do the math and you show them the business opportunity? Right.
Like right.
When I think about the hundreds of agents that have churned through my team, I'm fairly positive 90% of them would have never been astute enough to ask that kind of a question.
This person actually is trying to build a business.
Right.
At the bottom line, and they believe. That partnering with the hub, no different than any other business.
No different than buying a McDonald's franchise would be a smart way to go into business in the restaurant business.
Yeah, if you wanted to go into the restaurant business, that would be a definite model that allowed you to increase your probability of success. And so in this particular model.
Let's unpack that. That's interesting. So let's unpack that. What are they evaluating? What are they seeing in value? What are those things?
So let me.
If I don't want to get you off track, if you were on a track, so.
No, you got me going. Not off track. You got me on track. The reason why is because what I do know, and this isn't. I don't want this to come off the wrong way because we are still learning. But what I can tell you, what makes a really good partner, is somebody who was going to become a really good agent anyway. And that really good agent was not going to have any reluctancy to do any step in the business, but they would actually do a lot better and a lot faster, provided that you save them some of the wrong steps. Meaning, this isn't an individual that has a fixed mindset that says,
right.
I'm not willing to do it this way or willing to do it that way. I mean, we weren't like that. Most of the people who've had success in real estate, they were very open and flexible and trying to recreate and model other people's success. And so what that conversation is not, by partnering with us, you aren't responsible for your own success. What that conversation is here's what we're responsible for and here's what you're responsible
right.
for.
1,000%. That, can you say that one more time? Who's responsible? We're not responsible for
their success.
Right.
Yeah, because but it can be very misconstrued and very misrepresented if you say, well, we're going to just give you these appointments.
Right.
Well, let me tell you something. Things happen, right? In business, things happen. They're partnering with you because they believe if the market shifts and they're down into the foxhole, they want to be your partner. And
right.
I'm going to tell you right now, if you were in the foxhole and the market shifted, you'd want to be our partner.
Right.
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 I just know that because we've been in the foxhole. Right. Right. And so.
And the last thing you want to be in the person you as the business owner wants to be in partner with is someone in the foxhole that ain't willing to get out there and fight with you.
Exactly.
Right? And that's the difference. And you know, I instantly think of BC Reese just as a. You know, somebody who is just a great, great partner,
yeah.
Right? He's willing to do whatever it takes to be successful himself. And maybe there's an angle there that you're thinking, you know,
you're putting on a great podcast because you're stimulating amazing thought. You're like giving me goosebumps by the minute because this stuff excites me. The reason why when you said BC Reese, to give an update,
right?
Tatum.
Okay. Right.
Great partner.
Right.
Tatum was our first partner at his
first ever.
First right. ever. His first closing, he wanted to come ask me. He had forgot to ask me after he left his current brokerage after 8 years, or it might have been 10 years. But after he left his brokerage, he came at his first closing and said, "Listen, my first closing schedule, but I don't remember what my splits were."
Right.
He remembered the opportunity. He remembered what we were going to do. We went through all of that, but that wasn't, he was so excited in the partnership and what we were going to provide. And
right.
he was so confident that he could do his part that he was bought in.
Right.
His 1 year was technically August. July. So he started in June, but he had this, he had to untangle some of the relationships and things that he was in, which is kind of a, you know, from a partner standpoint, he joined, our brokerage, and so he became part of the Expert Advisor Home Services brokerage instead of his previous brokerage, and through that transition he would say, and he did say, that his first month was in July. This past July, if you look at his Facebook, he was catching sharks, taking his kids across all over Florida, riding Harleys with his dad.
Yeah.
You know, the guy's now got his pilot license, which is something he said he wanted to do for 10 years. He put 7 deals under contract. We went through these numbers with Mark out of Houston today. He turned in 7 deals, contracts, put under contract 7 deals, and had 3 listings go, put 3 listings on the market. These are things that he had. I mean, they're things that I remember back when we used to go to the lake and,
right.
you know, my business was humming.
Right. When you come back and you had commission checks on the desk
right.
from closing deals while you was out of town.
Yeah. And so to put full transparency on that, I've heard this, you know, with speaking to the people up here, because the referral partner is to me like the partner.
Right.
Right. Because to me, a good referral partner at NAEA is going to be a great partner if they're a great referral partner. That's
right.
just my personal
no question.
Opinion. And so... I was talking to one of the advisors here at NAEA, and they were kind of talking through the referral partner process. And what I learned was, in both of those scenarios, people they get discomfort when they don't know if they have a deal coming.
Right.
That's really the pain that they're tired of.
Right.
They're
roller coaster, right?
Yeah. They like to have consistent pipeline. And so, Jay, I want to make sure, like, there was a lot of space and things that we created to vet out our strategy. Let me say, the strategy was, you know, we were trying to build predictable pipelines because otherwise you have to have a model that allows you to build scalable business. Think about this. Scalable, instant business. You
right.
know, that's a lot harder than to build a pipeline, which you create the follow-up processes that continues to...
Spit them out, right?
And that and you can expand on that.
Oh, yeah, let me expand on that. So, for instance, my first... 3 buyer agents, which I had done 233 deals the year that I hired them. So I was fucking all over the place. But the way that I gave them deals was I was like, here's one, take that one. Here's one, take that one. Here's one, take that one. But those weren't predictable. They were just, as I was encountering them, or I would make a seller homeless, I was feeding them. But it wasn't in a way that was really that predictable. It was just like, here's my pipeline. Let me dump a few off on you. And here, you know, I was feeding them and keeping them busy. But it wasn't in a way that they could count on it, because I might give it to you. I might give it to the other agent, or I might give it to the next agent. You don't have no way of knowing for sure.
Right.
Right. And there wasn't enough clarity as to how many deals you might be creating just as the business owner. That you know to be able to say, yeah, I can do this for 3 agents or 4 and give you 4 deals a month, or someone you'll get 0, right? So like we built, you know, then I believe this, and I think I just want to make sure everybody is open to this, and I think everybody is like, you have to be willing to listen to this podcast knowing that there's a better way. You know what I'm saying? There could be a better way. Because like a lot of times we get confirmation bias. Like you're looking for things to confirm what you're doing is right. And I think that's something that really I would say thanks to you specifically. And, you know, always assuming first, going into every situation, thinking you're wrong, thinking we're wrong. We're probably wrong here. You know, just let's try to be less wrong, you know, than we could be or whatever. And that, you know, listening in to this conversation, don't look for the things that make your business model right. Look for where you might be wrong. Because if you're listening with that,
it's okay.
You're
not someone we're looking to work
with. Right, right. You just won't probably cross paths with us.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, and that's okay. But look for that. And that's what you're looking for. Those are the distinctions that you're trying to find in where you might be wrong in your model. And that's, you know, that was, you know, looking back, I want to say, well, fuck, it wasn't that way for me. Maybe, you know, maybe it just got worse. You know, you want to believe you were doing things right. But we buy these buyer lead generation tools that are home search. And for years, I mean, literally for years, and I'm talking even now in the top 100 agents in the country that we know and have talked to and work with. And I would say that when you go back to do the math, not all of them will say, what's the average days in the pipeline for a home search lead? And I know one person specifically, it gave me 460 something days before a lead that entered into the home search platform turned into a sale. That's a long damn time to create a pipeline. If you're partnering with someone and you're making that promise, like you're saying, you're my business partner, I need to produce deals for you, you know, every month, how am I gonna predictably do that? That is not a very viable solution because they're not gonna stick around for 464 days waiting for that first one to close.
Right.
Right? And I never looked at my pipeline like that before. I just didn't know what I didn't know.
Or their pipeline
either. They didn't even have a pipeline.
Right.
They were expected to call Fish Pond or whatever, yeah. Right? So whatever hustle, get, you know, make your calls. How many calls did you make today? If that's your sales meeting, then you're missing the boat. That sucks. We talked about that.
Well, what's going to happen is you're going to get your really good one is going to get on our podcast one day.
Right. Right. They're going to leave you anyway. I mean, yeah. they're
going to find a better way because they're going to look for a better
right.
way.
Right. And that's the thing you want to try to avoid. And I think the way you avoid that is by understanding what you've been saying. And I'm just echoing what you've been saying is you treat a partner like a partner.
Yeah.
And you look at them different. You look at them like, you know, if you were sitting here talking to us and you treat them with the respect of somebody that you would want to be a partner with. Like that's a different person. And
right.
when you do that and they go hustle just as hard as you hustle for them, you create this win-win environment where everybody's working together to grow and your goals are their goals and their goals are your goals. And it's just it's completely different than what we used to do.
It absolutely is. And one of the conversations I had about an hour ago was going back to your point about
Not that I didn't love my buyer agents either, too. Because it's not that I didn't love them. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I wanted them to be successful.
But let me ask you successful. A question. Quick question. What would you have done to get them more leads?
What would I have done?
Because the agent that I just spoke to, doing 400 deals, had a call with her an hour and a half ago. Her problem is that she's on her second platform, and when she runs the search terms, her ad shows up, and then it's her competitor's ad who owns the same search portal, and then it's another competitor, and it's like she's round robining her search. She can't do anything. It's
right.
against her terms on one of her platforms to run pay per click, because that's just the way those services work. You actually sign off that I will not run pay per click to my own site, and so. What is that? And her exact problem is she doesn't have enough opportunity. She can see them out there.
Right.
But she can't go get them. And at the end of the day, she did not build the internal muscle
right.
to be able to go out there and compete with those platform people that are now have those economies of scale and are basically telling her what piece of the pie that they're willing to give her based upon what they're willing to do.
Can we talk about let's So let's unpack that a little bit.
It goes to, let me get, go ahead. The point is like we had a conversation today with Facebook, right? When you spend a certain amount, the difference with, let me give you an example. As in our model, we have a relationship. Recently, you were talking earlier.
We're spending over $120,000 a month with Facebook, and you get a representative that shows you some tools that you don't get as just the average Joe. That you're investing enough money now that you get access to the behind the scenes, way optimized ways to generate traffic through Facebook.
Okay, and so there's that. Okay, that's one thing. A new thing. Released today on Facebook. So there's this. That's right. One of our competitive advantages, right?
Right, right.
Second thing is they have a new thing where you can retarget within Facebook based upon, an example would be a guy goes up and says, I'm selling in 9 months. You can, when he drops down 9 months, you can retarget him in 9 months. You can retarget him. You can retarget them based upon how they segmented themselves because Facebook is now making all of their answers live and their ads live within Facebook.
Right.
That's a new feature that came out today. Most people, A, will never learn that.
Right.
B, if they do learn that, it won't be advantageous for their lead platform to do anything with it.
Right.
So they're not even going to exercise it. So they're going to have to compete with people like us.
Right.
They're going to do all the new ways. But right. They're already set up on a machine that's just going to pump.
Well, first of all, they don't have somebody that they've partnered with that is they're truly their partner.
Exactly.
They have bought a platform. And let's talk about, like, okay, what are your options? You have these platforms. They have recently sold for a lot of money. So as we've helped build many of those companies, they were great lead generation platforms. They're great technologies. They solve a lot of our problems in the business. But now as mega teams and as producing agents that are doing well in their marketplace, you run up against the limit of now they're starting to sell more platforms in your area than what the original agreement was, and that's starting to happen, and that it's become more and more of a problem. What are your choices? What can you do about that? Let's say that we were in that position. We're not in AEA. We're sitting here listening. We're like, yes, I know this is happening. And sucks. What do you do?
So can I just say what we currently do? Okay. So what we currently do is we have a promise of an amount of leads we're going to deliver to a market service area.
No, I'm saying. No, that's how we have control of it. They don't.
Right.
So I guess the point I'm trying to make is, if you're stuck with multiple platforms, or you're trying to expand to another area and you got to try to buy another platform and one's not available, first of all, you'll never get economies of scale trying to do it that way. And you'll go broke trying to expand if that was what you're trying to do. But the only way to win this game, truly win this game and be in this business long term is to have control of your own lead generation is what we're saying. And if you don't have scalable lead generation that you control with your own ad budget, instead of being hogtied to a platform that has rules around whether you can even run any marketing to it, you'll never, not to mention if you don't have something that's differentiated, because a home search is just a home search. That's not even close to something you can scale or make predictable. The only way to do that is to own your own lead generation and really build that muscle, like you said, of knowing how to. And I promise you don't spend $120,000 a month on Facebook and then introduce Google AdWords at a similar click unless you know what the hell it is you're doing. And you've built a way to distribute leads by territory specifically to an agent in a marketplace. You have to master those skills. But I think the bigger problem that people don't see in the industry that's coming. And it's coming, and it's the big bear, as you always say. It's coming. It's behind you.
Fuzzy
Wuzzy is not a friendly bear. This motherfucker is going to eat your ass when he catches you.
Right.
And that is the fact that the home search, when the way buyers search, when they get to Google, it's too late. You at some point it will be too late. And until you start using data to identify what a likely target is and be predictive about people that are thinking of buying or selling instead of just using you know, the mechanisms that are out there for us today, which you still, like, they're already a level below that. They're not using, they're not controlling their own Google. They're not controlling their own Facebook. So that's the first step. The deeper level of understanding where you got to go to skate to where the puck is going, not to, you know, where you think it is now, is understanding data and understanding how to utilize data to identify someone who's thinking of making a move before they do that home search, where you can actually convert that traffic before anybody else ever has an opportunity to get it.
Right.
And I think that's the underlying strategy that makes an unbeatable, makes, and it's not unbeatable, you can always screw it up, but that's where you have to invest. If you want to get away from the business model you have and try to fix this ultimately, and you don't want to do it through us, which is fine if you want to do that, but that's what they have to do. And I'm just trying to give people some nuggets for, yeah, like, you know, how do I solve this problem, you know, for myself, right?
Absolutely. I totally get it.
And so go back to what your answer was, because that's where you were going for.
No. But I think what I was going to say is, you know,
what you provide the agent, right?
Yeah. Like, when we sit down and this is, we control the ad, we have a promise that we're delivering, and there is an overall budget. And at the end of the day, we're making sure on a weekly basis. Now we look and we change ads, we change things. But we have, the biggest thing is, what works in one place doesn't work in another place the same way.
That's what sucks about trying to scale things.
Exactly. Right. And so you have to, by default, you know, you have to have multiple ways in which you basically have your customer acquisition.
You gotta have a bunch of tools in your tool belt.
Exactly. And so you can't say it any other way. And so on the buy side, with this one particular person's situation, is first of all, when we encounter that we need more traffic, buyer search, we actually create a plan and a strategy, and we execute it. And as a result, does every single time it work just like we want? Well, it hasn't been bad. I can tell you, we're always trying to get better. There will be a day where something happens in our, it's happened here, where the ads don't perform like they were supposed to.
We run the checklist. We did this, we did this, we did this, we did this, we did these 8 things that usually fix that problem, and it still doesn't work.
Right.
Like, there are markets that are just like that.
Yeah.
And you run into those, and it's like, what the hell, you know, what do you do? You have to go to another, you have to have another lever you can pull.
Right. And the other thing that happened is, like, when Facebook changed something completely that had nothing to do with the MSAs, it just made the entire traffic source change.
That cost us $40,000 in 2 weeks.
Right. But we now have that muscle,
right,
to fight that battle.
We also have a faster response mechanism.
Right.
when that happens, quicker response time will soften the pain.
Right. And if you're on a platform, you just think, oh man, it was a slow month.
Right. Then you call your lead provider, usually 60 days later, because you hadn't really been paying attention.
You didn't
attention.
Even really realize it, yeah.
Right. You know, one of your agents was just bitching,
yes,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then it's like, hey, what's going on, you know, with my lead? Oh, well, I can't explain. Well, we sold 10 more fucking platforms in your area. That's what happened. That's the truth, but I'm not going to tell you that.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm telling you, like, as much as we love those technologies, as much as everybody here has got their business built on them, you are fucked if that's what you're building your business on. If you think it's going to be all, you know, every one of us have gone through it too, and we just go to the next one and go to the next one and go to the next one. When are you going to realize that is only going to crater and fall apart because you don't understand the business model that they're in is building a technology company that sells at a high multiple, and they're going to go sell it. Like, who has your best interest in heart? Who really wants to help you with your business and isn't looking? It doesn't matter when they invest, when they get investment capital, the minute that they get investment capital, they no longer have full control of their business, and that the investor is going to monetize that platform. And the way to monetize it is not to just let you have one platform. That's not going to be what happens. So they're going to say, well, why don't you provide this to everybody? Which is the ultimate reason why it happens every time, and it will continue to happen, and you're going to continue to not be able to drive the results. The other thing is, all the while you're monkeying around with these platforms, trying to figure out how to make your buyer agents make their calls to leads that are 464 days gestation period before they're going to buy anyways, All the while, your big box brokers, your Howard Hannas, your companies that are investing millions of dollars in technology, your Redfins that have $166 million invested in their technology are kicking your ass, and they are taking your market share right out from under your nose where you're not going to get it.
Taking it back.
And the broker is taking back, and we'll talk about this the next session and the next upcoming podcast maybe or one thereafter. But understanding the fundamentals that these companies are getting smarter. They realize that we built these teams with some ridiculously inefficient business practices that we don't have dialed in, and that we try to get our 50-50 splits back with our agents, and that worked. It worked, and we all dominated, and these brokers are left going, everybody's leaving and going to the next best commission split, and they're trying to figure out how to stay in business. And let me tell you something, they got a lot of damn money. So they're going to figure it out, and they're going to spend that money, and they're going to invest that money in ways to gain the efficiencies and get those agents that are your current agents right now, and they're going to provide them appointments. They're going to provide them because they're gaining efficiencies. They can spend more money than you on leads because why? Because they have efficiencies. They built technologies, they built call centers, and it's coming bigger and faster than you've ever seen. All you gotta do is Google investing in real estate, in the real estate industry. Look at how many hundreds of millions of dollars have been investing in trying to disrupt this industry. The teams are more at risk than the AFA. Originally, that was my belief, was the AFA was at risk. Who's really at risk is that big inefficient team. That big inefficient team that is trying to do it with a volume of 50 agents doing a deal, 1.7 deals per month is the agent that's going to be left with. You better have stacked some cash.
Yeah, we call that the little broker.
Right, the little broker, the baby broker.
The baby broker, right. Who calls himself a team.
Right, it's like,
it feels like the big broker.
That is, and it's not to be hateful or disrespectful, but let's be honest, our team efficiency, a level of efficiency in our teams at 4, 5, 6, 7, 800 deals is not very dialed in.
Right,
I'm saying, like, for most of us, right? Like, some of you listening right now are being like, bullshit, you ain't seen my shit's efficient. Okay, all right, I can hear you. I'm good with that. That's fine. But most of us, if we had to peel back the curtain and look at it, like, we would be embarrassed, right? We'd be like, I probably should have hit the gym, before I peeled back that curtain. You know what I'm saying? So it's just that's just the reality of it. And if somebody's got millions of dollars to invest is going to win because they can afford to outspend you to get the customer. They're gonna put efficiencies in scale. They're damn sure not gonna let some platform determine what they're able to do to generate their own business, right? So, this is a real problem that I'm actually just really impressed that we've done what we've been able to do. It is a testament to the people here at NAEA and the amazing amount of talent that works here and the passion on, like, just freaking going for it and making it better and fixing and taking that control back really giving a damn about the real estate profession, the industry, and the right people, and the expert advisor brand, and really differentiating ourselves from the rest of the pack, and creating a lifeboat that can survive disruption that's coming, ultimately create a business entity that's has an exit strategy that all the problems that we've identified and talked about in every one of these podcasts, it just gives us the ability to go do something big and make a huge difference in the world. So it has definitely been impressive what I've seen this company be able to accomplish in such a short period of time. A lot of lessons along the way too.
Yeah.
Painful lessons. But it's worth it.
It is worth it.
Is there anything, I feel like you may have gone down this vein enough, but I feel like the one last thing we might want to just tie a bow on before we call it a day is the that promise. I just want to expand on it because you did go quite a few levers deep on it. But let's expand on the promises that are made to a partner and what does that mean in terms of your day-to-day operations? So like, where does your focus go from where it used to go to going on listing appointments, managing your ISA kind of half-ass, doing the training for your buyer agents and your team, talking to your operations manager and things of that nature? Like as a you know, somebody that's doing 400, 500, 600 deals, whatever it is, you know, a big team that is, you know, like, what would this thing look like if I was doing this? Where is that person's focus start to shift to in terms of their business with promising and partnering with people, making this promise, I'm gonna deliver to you in this specific area and get you producing and focusing on those business, you know, that business unit. What does the difference in their day look like? What do you feel like is,
man,
different?
You know, and this might be the same, but I believe that somebody who's running an area becomes really effective at coaching somebody. I mean, when we coach somebody into their business and growing their business, that's what you're essentially doing. Is,
right.
You know, you've done it, and instead of doing it, there's more opportunity to go out there and help other people do it than,
right,
you could ever do on your own.
Right.
And so you're really, it's a really, I think from a purpose standpoint, it's a really, it's very, there's this contribution of giving and helping that you feel when you're working with someone who's working with the customer or the consumer versus every day you're out there trying to articulate and beat the agent down the street to get someone to do business with you versus them. So, you know, if you think about what makes somebody successful, you know, typically it's changing the way that they think. And so, you know, what happens is, especially if you have processes and systems, you get the transparency in saying, man, this person's doing good over here. You understand what the bottlenecks were, our challenges, our mindset shifts that a person has to go through to grow the business. So you have an awareness that they don't have.
Right.
And your goal is, through understanding their frustrations when they hit plateaus, is to be able to remove those barriers by helping them ultimately think differently, make different decisions, and grow. I mean, as a coach, you're actually downloading the models in your mind,
right,
and giving them to them so that they can obviously process things differently. I'll give you an example. With Tatum, there was a time where Tatum, you know, he had a lot. I mean, probably the record amount of listings, and you know, he was uncertain about, because he had just, he didn't know where his next appointment was going to come from. And I've had conversations with him, and 45 days later, you know, his pipeline's fully rocking and he's doing well. But that my goal in that relationship is to kind of help him think through, first of all, understand why it is that way. I mean,
right,
you need to understand the business model and the leading indicators that would allow you to look forward. In his situation, specifically, and this, it reminds me of another situation where you're trying, in our model, we're trying to make them understand where to focus their time. So
right,
one partner has more nurtures, right? But they're looking at now business, and they,
right,
don't, you know, they're focused here when their opportunity is right here. So it's that constant reminder of,
well,
what they can be doing.
The mechanism that you created, and I think you're talking about maybe before it was the you know, the individual model was created, right? Or during that time where, when you have an individual model where you can see, hey, you've got 8 nurtures, that equals, because in the financial model and in, you know, the forecasting, it's based on real time data, and
right,
we know what the results of that is. Somebody says they're moving in 6 months, certain number of those will, certain number of them aren't. But you can predict that 8 months from now that's going to result in whatever, right? Or whatever the number is, right?
Yeah, so
you can see that. You can see your future. You can see what's coming. And then now that fear, or that, you know, that resentment or that questioning,
that disempowering,
right,
emotion. And so the way,
exactly,
that, what happens is that in that model, you have to really build out. So an example with the nurture is you're identifying people that are going to move in the next 12 months. And so when you call this month,
right,
you have none this month, and then you might have 12, 16, 13, 2 in August, 2 in December, right?
Right.
And then the next month you do it again, and you're at 90 days, because month one you had none in that month. But they,
right.
So if you, let's say you set another 60, they fall. And what happens in this scenario where I was saying is, it's not, you're explaining to them the process as they're living it out, because they never experienced it yet. So our August, we've had more nurtures this month than any other month. But what our inside sales manager focuses on is a contact rate per those nurtures. And what we always have to do is there's a baseline. And there's a baseline that if we don't set an exact amount, then our pipeline is shrinking.
Right.
And so what you're coaching them on is how to run their business off the numbers.
Right.
And so as a result, it wasn't that Tatum had any problems.
Right.
He just was looking at listings versus at nurtures. What he should have been was saying, dang, man, I got 83 new nurtures versus, man, where's my next closing?
Right.
And it's changing that behavior as, as they look at leading indicators versus lagging and that training of them on understanding the value that we're providing them.
Right. That's a huge deal. Number one, that, you know, again, as we continue the theme of the distinction between a partner and a buyer agent on our team, you know, that's a huge gift. Number one, to be working with someone that's coachable and willing to look at their business from a pipeline perspective versus I need to eat right now. So that's a huge distinction, I think, that everyone should be paying attention to. What was my original question?
The last question I don't know the original part, where you jumped in was, it was before, you know, we had those dash, you were explaining the pipeline.
Right.
And I was just explaining to you about specifically.
Yeah.
Sorry, I don't know.
That's all good. I don't remember ADHD. I can't remember what the question was. Anyways, I think you may have covered it, but it'll come back to me. How many episodes in a row has this been the case where my ADHD kicks in? I think it's a gift. I think that made the point. Is there anything else that you want to cover as it relates to that, the difference between partner, the difference between the buyer agent, the discussion we've had about controlling your lead generation, don't just make the mistake of calling your buyer agent a partner and thinking you solved the problem. Is there anything else that we want to leave them with today?
Man, the only thing that I think I would leave it with how you started it. If the biggest gift, you know, all of the things that we're talking about on this podcast, regardless of where you are in this particular thing, just to be a better entrepreneur, a better business person, a better spouse, think you're wrong, you know, you're wrong, because in the moment that you operate from that mindset, you start becoming open to everything that you might not be seeing. And there's this self-preservation and this almost like this confirmation bias. These things that we do that hold us back really are I think they're embedded in us from early on in the evolution process of when we're almost have like animal instincts, right?
I've read several books on the studies that have been done that back up exactly what you're saying. We have these animal instincts that we don't even know. We don't even know why we react, the fight or flight and things of that nature.
Exactly. And what I think that makes people really creative and really beautiful minds is, you know, they understand and they're trying to seek how to think differently, and they're looking for places on how to think differently. I know that's definitely, I saw the personal shift in my mind where I felt like I was able to receive and learn and grow as a result of trying to find a better way. And so I think all we're trying to do is with partner is ultimately, I remember when we were in the British Virgin Islands back in May, there is a bigger opportunity in helping agents sell 100 deals than there are in trying to go personally sell 1,000 deals.
Right.
And what I'm more interested in is creating opportunity. Because I think what we've concluded is that the best opportunity that we have is trying to create as much opportunity for others. And in that concept, in that mindset,
right,
is what lives partner.
Right.
It's a different than self-serving. It becomes where you're trying to, and it is a shift in, you know, I think that a lot of times if you're not ready, because maybe just, you know, right now you're just thinking about you and your paycheck and those types of things, there's a lot of filters that get put up that will make it hard to see.
Man, you should rewind this podcast back the last 2 minutes that Michael's been talking, and you should listen to it, and you should stop, and you should listen to it. You should pull your car over. You should listen to it. Like, I can't even tell you how powerful it is.
That's where I think, and I think that's the best gift that we're giving, and what I think they will realize from us is we'll admit where we're wrong.
Right.
And we're going to say that we're not always right. We know we're wrong.
Right.
We don't know where we're wrong.
We're going to crash into the wall.
Yep. We're going to continue to figure out where we're wrong. We're going to get on this podcast. We're going to say, man, that wasn't right and that wasn't right, just like we've done for the last 10 years.
Right.
And we're going to say, this is where it is. And through there, through the bumpers and the gutters and the ooms and the ahs,
right,
we're going to end up at the finish line. And the great thing is we're going to do it with a lot of great people. And the one thing that we're going to need in order to make this vision a reality is a lot of amazing people.
Right.
And so if we don't know how we're going to create opportunity for you, that's what we go to bed thinking,
right,
is how to put all the fires together and go out there and make a difference in the real estate community. That's what we're excited about. And at the essence of partner, that's what we feel more excited about than we did coaching.
Right. And it's, man, you said a lot of really great stuff there. It's also about shifting. If you don't feel like you're fulfilled, you know, at the end of the day, if you feel like, I don't know how many years you've been in real estate, how many years you've been doing it, how old you are. I mean, we hear all these different stories. We get all these different emails and text messages and calls, and everybody's at a different place in life. And if you don't feel like you're fulfilled, if you're not building wealth, if you're not getting to where you want to go, I don't know where you go to find somebody that's going to help you with that. You know what I'm saying? Like, but that's, you got to find that place. And if it's not us, then find that place. This is about, you know, shifting gears and, you know, shifting from a business that's focused on management and shifting to a life that's about leadership. And we're about helping build, you know, build people and create opportunity. And could have said it better than Michael said it. So hopefully our paths will cross. I will say the best, you know, I'm, you know, in terms of the vibrations. Is that me?
I think so.
I'm getting a phone call. It's Albie Stasek. We should answer. I should have answered it. Well, he definitely backed up that last comment, I guess, right?
Yeah.
So yeah. So the one thing I would say, and I don't know, and my intent is not to sell anything, but the one thing that I can tell you, like this year at the Exponential Growth Summit, the people that we have there and the place that they come from, the personal leadership and the personal growth. If you didn't hear, like if you didn't rewind back and listen to what Michael said and hear something different, man, I just encourage you to find a way to be at the Exponential Growth Summit and be in the room and listen to Gary D. Rodriguez and listen to Jimmy Lee and listen to what it is that we have to share. And I think the difference that it can make in your personal life and the rest of your life, regardless of where you end up or who you end up with in terms of where your business is, will be the greatest experience of your life. So I feel like we owe it to them to at least, if that opportunity hasn't passed, to make available, you know, you need to be at the Exponential Growth Summit because it's going to get real fun.
Yeah.
So that's all we got.
Yeah.
I know we got some shit to do today.
Absolutely. Leave a comment. Give us feedback.
Yeah. Hey, make sure that you give us a review if you're digging what we're providing. Yeah, that's a good idea. So if you leave a review, you could win a ticket to EGS this year. We'll make that the deal. So actually, yeah, I like that. That's awesome. So leave a review, and we'll give you an opportunity to get a free ticket to EGS. So. Anything else we need to cover?
Man, nope. Appreciate everybody. We'll see you next time.
Right. We'll see you either at the top
or from the top.